knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
The next reaction we will discuss was invented in 1967 by American chemist Robert H. Shapiro, who was at that time a professor at the University of Colorado in Boulder. This reaction is actually a very powerful modification of the classical Bamford-Stevens reaction, developed in 1952 by British chemist William Bamford and Scottish chemist Thomas Stevens. So we will cover both reactions in this video, as they are indeed closely related and are often confused for one another. Both reactions deal with the fragmentation chemistry of sulfonyl hydrazones. We have already discussed the condensation of ketones with hydrazine and the subsequent reduction of the resulting hydrazone, which was the Wolff-Kishner reaction. Just like for regular hydrazones, making sulfonyl hydrazones from ketones is quite easy. One needs to condense the carbonyl compound with a sulfonyl hydrazine, typically paratolyl hydrazine, with removal of water, usually by azeotropic distillation. Tosyl hydrazones are usually solid crystalline compounds, which makes their purification convenient. We have to remember that sulfonamides are quite acidic, their pKa being in the range of 12 to 17, and tosyl hydrazones, being related to sulfonamides, are also acidic and can be deprotonated by alkoxide bases. Bamford and Stevens discovered that the anionic salts of tosyl hydrazones are thermally unstable and decompose to alkenes, nitrogen gas, and sulfonate salts. The alkenes formed are, in principle, a mixture of E and Z isomers, and in addition, two possible regiochemistries are possible, so four products can be formed. The mechanism of this reaction is postulated to take two possible pathways. In the first, the tosyl hydrazone salt loses a good leaving group, like sulfonate, by thermal action, leading to what is formally a nitrene, in resonance with a dipolar form. This intermediate is a diazoalkane, and we have encountered these substances already. As we have seen in a previous tutorial, diazoalkanes are very unstable because upon heating they lose the very stable nitrogen molecule, leaving behind a carbene. Carbenes are also unstable and smoothly undergo 1-2 hydride shifts to form alkenes. There are four hydrogens next to the carbene carbon, so depending on the geometry of the transition state, one can get some selectivity, with E-alkenes being preferred. In a protic solvent, the diazo compound can be protonated to form a diazonium salt, another unstable species, which solvolyzes by expelling the stable nitrogen molecule and forming a carbenium ion, which also undergoes a 1-2 hydride shift to give an alkene, again as a mixture of isomers. Therefore, the reaction works in both protic and aprotic solvents, though via two different mechanisms. For the Shapiro reaction, the substrate is the same as that in the Bamford-Stevens reaction, perhaps made by enolate alkylation of the corresponding ketone, then tosyl hydrazone formation. This is followed by the addition of not one equivalent of base, like in the BS reaction, but now two equivalents of a very strong base, like butyl lithium. A strong base is capable of forming a dianion. The first anion we have seen already. Now, if you think of the tosyl hydrazone anion as being similar to a carbonyl compound, you can imagine that forming the enolate may be possible, although the first negative charge discourages formation of another one close to it. That's why we need a super strong base. The dianion undergoes the fragmentation reaction, but this time the proton is lost not in a 1-2 shift after tosyl hydrazone breakdown, but before, forming an enolate. And here there is selectivity, as usually the more acidic position of the tosyl hydrazone is selected. Fragmentation of sulfonate and nitrogen occurs later in two steps, leading to a vinyl lithium species, which is stable in most ether solvents at low temperatures, and can be quenched with a number of useful electrophiles. Addition of iodine leads to a vinyl iodide. Addition of TMS chloride yields a vinyl silane. Addition of an aldehyde yields an allylic alcohol, and quenching with a proton yields a simple alkene. We must note that tosyl hydrazones from aldehydes do not work because the butyl lithium adds to the CN double bond and does not form the dianion. This is a very versatile reaction and has been used often in complex syntheses. For example, in the total synthesis of Taxol, described by Professor Nicolau while at Scripps Research Institute in La Jolla. Taxol is an important anti-cancer drug originally isolated from the bark of the tree Taxus baccata, commonly called the yew tree. As you can see, the key reaction joining ring A and C is a Shapiro reaction. The hydrazone used nowadays is usually the trisyl, which means 1,3,5 triisopropyl phenyl hydrazone. This gives slightly better yields than the tosyl hydrazone and is generally preferred. The vinyl lithium intermediate is quenched at low temperature by this very complex aldehyde to yield the condensation product in very good yield upon warming to room temperature. An added bonus is that under the reaction conditions, the formation of the new stereogenic center is quite selective, yielding the alpha alcohol, which matches the stereochemistry of the product. Taxol is then obtained in a number of steps, which form the B ring and allow for the correct positioning of each function. It is interesting that a master synthetic chemist like Professor Nicolau has chosen the Shapiro reaction as a key step in creating this complex molecule, which is only one of many applications of this important reaction.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.